We've looked at some different things. Go back and kind of capture some of them with you real quick here. We actually kicked the series off back on April the 11th when my son Blake was here, and he preached about the importance of investing your life in other people, building relationships that are productive, not just relationships that are surface, but relationships that go deep. Talked about the importance of discipleship and personal relationships. I want to encourage you to grow through that and be a part of that. Involve yourself in the groups of our church. We have groups that meet quite frequently on Sunday morning at 9:30. There are Christian living classes. Encourage you to be a part of that. There's a Wednesday night groups that meet throughout the building with a lot of different variety. And all the information for those things is on our website. Also on Sunday nights, we normally have community groups. Those will be taking a little of a break through the summertime. There's some special events that are in there. And we encourage you to be involved in non-formalized groups. It doesn't have to be something the church is doing. You know, I've seen this all my life. That sometimes there are people that say, well, I just wish the church would do something about that. Let me help you out with a word right now, a phrase for you to understand. Everybody say, I am the church. Okay, do something about it then. Don't wait for somebody else. Don't sit back thinking, I wish that... If God's put it in your heart, do it. Now, if you need help, then come to the pastors. By the way, Ephesians chapter 4 tells us that the purpose for pastors is to equip the saints. How many of you are a saint or at least sitting by one? Say amen. If you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you are a saint. The purpose of pastors is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Communication helps. Let us know what you need. We got a lot of pastors at our church. We can go one-on-one with you very easily, depending on what you need in life, and help you in that journey. But whatever the church needs to be doing, let's do it. And you can have a group that you get together and have coffee on one day of the week and talk about God and talk about life and encourage each other, or whatever it is you need to do. You need to have somebody meet you at lunch, give me a call. I'll even buy. How's that for inviting yourself out on your own dime? We want to invest in you. We want to help you grow spiritually. We want to help you find the niche. And if you're already there, we simply want to cheerlead and just encourage and applaud what you're doing. Blake talked about the importance of having this connection in relationship to growth and spiritual development. Then we talked about the importance of obeying God's word. It's not just knowing the word of God, but obeying the word of God. Then the next week we looked at being devoted to prayer. It's not just praying occasionally, kind of throwing up a Hail Mary when you're having a problem and hoping that's going to solve it, but be devoted to prayer. That's what we want to encourage for everyone in our church. By the way, we have a designated time every month. We invite the whole church to come Wednesdays at 6:15 for about a 30-minute prayer time together. It's kind of a combination of led and individual. And so you can come and we'll help guide you through it and give you direction. But it's a great time to come together as a church to pray. But beyond any prayer program, we want people to be people of prayer. That it's what we do because it's who we are. Then out in Garrison talked to us about investing in the work of the kingdom and recognizing what God wants us to do and move us to new places, move into the next step. And then we talked about strong families. We value strong families. Last week we talked about we value the Lordship of Jesus Christ. I don't think I skipped any. That brings us today on Pentecost Sunday to make this declaration. We value the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And when I talk about the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, it is absolutely critical that we recognize that is not intended by God to be a Sunday, Wednesday thing. It's not for an hour and 20 minutes on Sunday morning or just at certain points of your life. But you need the power of the Spirit working in your life every moment of every day. Acts chapter 1. I have trouble reading one verse because I want to make sure you get the context, so I gave you 12 of them today. In the first book, O Theophilus, Theophilus is a really neat Greek name. Theo is for God, Philos is the word for lover of God, so that the name Theophilus means lover of God. Anybody named Theophilus in the room? Theophilus? There you go. That's lover of God. I have dealt with all that Jesus, notice this word, this is Luke writing. I dealt with all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Now, when Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished," he was not making a declaration of cessation from effort. He wasn't saying, "I'm done, I wash my hands, and good luck for the rest of you." His statement of "it is finished" was actually a pronouncement in the Greek language that would translate better for us probably as "paid in full." And his statement is one of "the debt has been erased." Now, how many of you know that he is still at work? He is sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and for me right now. How powerful is that? Luke says here that the recording of his book by his name was simply the statement of what Jesus began to do. Here's the phrase we would probably put in our vernacular. He was just getting started. That's the gospel. It's just Jesus getting started. You haven't seen anything yet. What he's going to do now becomes laid out in the book of Acts. And it says he did this until the day when he was taken up after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit. How many of you are glad that Jesus gives us commands, not suggestions or ideas? We need to obey. That's our response. Not debate. If Jesus said it, you need to do it. It will bring life and healing and strength to your existence. After command through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them. Command is a strong word. To order somebody, to me, almost seems even more personal and intentional. Commands kind of, in my mind, it just seems a little more generic. But when somebody orders me to do something, it gets personal at that moment. He ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You have heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." Okay, have any of you ever struggled with just not getting it when it comes to the things of God? You don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to acknowledge it and humble yourself before the congregation. But I would suspect we've all been there at one time or another. Where we're like, "I don't really understand what you're doing, God. I don't really understand what this point of this whole thing is." The reason why is because most of us aren't very fluent in God. We don't speak God very well. And by nature, we don't even understand it at all. I was thinking of just a crazy weird illustration of people who don't get it. And is there anyone like me in the room that really believes that we're going to have Dr. Pepper at the marriage supper of the Lamb because it is the nectar of heaven? A bunch of heathen out there. No one believes it with me. Have you ever been to a restaurant and asked for Dr. Pepper? And had the waiter or the waitress say back to you, "We don't have Dr. Pepper, but we have root beer." I've had that happen. And I think, in what cosmos does me asking for Dr. Pepper even equate with root beer? You might as well have just said, "We have oranges." I know what root beer is, and I didn't ask for that. I asked for Dr. Pepper. What we have here, to quote an old movie line, is a failure to communicate. Why is it that we don't always get it? It's because we don't speak God. And the less the Holy Spirit is in us, the less God we speak. So the disciples, here's where I'm leading to. This is one of the craziest verses in Scripture. There's some others, but this is toward the top of the list anyway. Jesus just gives this whole thing about, I've been with you for 40 days. Go to Jerusalem, wait for the promise, and you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. It's going to be this incredible life-changing thing. And they ask him, Lord, when are you going to beat up the Romans? Wait, what? Do I want root beer? What? They ask a question that absolutely reveals their carnality, their human view of life. Now, don't get too hard on these guys, because often we do the same thing. We get stuck in this spot where we have to say, God, I don't understand. What are you doing? And God says, hear my voice, let my spirit bear witness with you. But too often we walk by sight and not by faith. Jesus said, it's not for you to know the times or the season the Father is fixed by his own authority. But I love the way Jesus does this. He quickly and kindly rebukes them, and then he points back to what he said to begin with. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit's come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they're gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. As you go on through the chapter, you find out they devoted themselves to prayer again. Let me talk about the Holy Spirit just very quickly this morning and a few thoughts for you. First of all, I want you to understand this in the introduction of the sermon here is the Holy Spirit did not make an appearance for the first time in the book of Acts. He was very active beforehand. Jesus did not make his appearance for the first time in the Gospels. He made it for the first time in human flesh. The Holy Spirit shows up here now as the one who will work with the followers of Christ to help them in a new way. But the Holy Spirit was active in the Old Testament. Three times in the book of Judges, it says the Holy Spirit's power came upon Samson and he had miraculous strength. Micah chapter 2 verse 8 makes this declaration saying that, let me find the right verse here. That the power of God was available for the servant of God, that he would come upon him. Zechariah 4:6 is a verse that we've used many times in the assemblies of God that says, it's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. In 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 6, the word of God says, and the spirit of God will come upon you in power, and you will prophesy with them, and you will be changed into a different person. That's in 1 Samuel 10, 6, and it was in reference to Saul the king. The Holy Spirit was very active in the Old Testament concerning the Messiah. Isaiah states that he will be filled with the power of the Spirit. Now, when we talk about the Trinity and the Godhead, we're talking God, and if we have just human language, it's really hard to comprehend. And to be very candid, I understand it, but it's a bit above my pay grade. And trying to articulate how that all works is a little bit difficult. I think in most cases with the things of God, it's better to focus on what we know than allow ourselves to be confused by what we don't know or don't understand. In the Godhead, it's three yet one, one yet three. The Father's not the Son, the Son's not the Spirit. They are three separate, yet they are one. I was thinking about this, and every time you see some modern movie, you go back to Greek mythology or whatever, and there's this the different people involved in rulership of gods or whatever. Normally there's animosity. Normally there's like trying to find the weakness so you can overcome the other one, and all these things are going on. But in the in the Godhead that we see in Scripture, there's absolute and complete unity. In a way that is far beyond anything we can even grasp or understand as humans. It's beyond our comprehension, the unity of God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. The old hymn, Holy, 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 and we sing it sometimes in different varieties of sound, but it has a spot in there that says, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. So here's what I know about the Trinity in a very big generic picture. God the Father is the one who initiates creation. The Son and the Spirit are both involved. They're never isolated from each other. They're never on separate journeys. But God the Father is the initiator of creation. God spoke and the world came into existence. The Father is seen in creation, in the creation of man. Now the Spirit and the Son were there with him, cooperating and working together. But it's the Father who has that initiatory type response to creation. Jesus primarily initiates redemption. The fact that he left heaven, came and lived on the earth like us, died on the cross in our place, it was all for one purpose, for the redemption of man, for the reconciliation between God and man. Sin had created a gulf that we could not in any way cross over, so Jesus came and laid his life down and provided redemption, restoration between God and man. The Holy Spirit is told by Jesus to be the one who will come and who will guide us in all truth. And the Holy Spirit initiates spiritual growth and development in the life of a believer. Now, as a church, we are Pentecostal. Now, let me give you the most broad use of that word, and it's the way that I mean it right now. Yes, we believe in the experience of Acts chapter 2. Yes, we believe in what happened on the day of Pentecost, but it's more than just an experience. It is a lifestyle. We want to be people who are walking in God. We believe it in faith. We believe it to be true. We believe in the fullness of God's provision for every believer. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. We believe in it, but not only do we believe in it, that would be in faith. We accept it as truth, but we believe in it as practice. In other words, we don't only believe in the provision of God's fullness for every believer, we want to experience it personally. We want to walk in the fullness of God. We want to experience all that he has for us. Now, the Holy Spirit's work in the individual is to give us daily victory. He leads us from victory to victory. When you look at the Old Testament, one of my favorite verses, and it's translated a couple of different ways depending on the version used, and the Hebrew's a little bit unclear maybe, but I love the way the New King James says Psalm 68:19, I believe it is. Blessed be the Lord who daily loads us with benefits, the God of our salvation. God is at work in our lives to give us daily victory. And we experience daily victory as we are filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus commanded his followers to receive the promise of the Holy Spirit. I love the juxtaposition of those words. There's this command to receive. I like for people to command me to receive something. It's kind of a nice thing. Jesus says, I'm commanding you to receive the promise of the Father, which is power for daily living through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Luke 24:49 speaks of that, and again in Acts chapter 1, we read it just moments ago. So let me give you three thoughts about the Holy Spirit. Number one is this, the Holy Spirit fills us according to our desire. Now, I've been in Assembly of God Church all of my life. I was probably there the first Sunday. I think I was born on a Tuesday, and my mom's here, and she can verify or she can say it didn't work out that way. I don't remember, but I would imagine I was there probably the first Sunday, and if not, shortly thereafter, and I haven't missed too many since. So I've been around church a long time, and here's what I've discovered about church. God is always working. God is always working. God is always speaking. And when there are hungry hearts, when there are listening ears, they recognize the presence of God. A couple things we say every time we come together. We pray that you will feel the power of God's presence. And I don't know, I hope I say this in a way that is accurate and clear. You feeling the presence of God in your life is a little bit dependent upon you. If you have no hunger, it's hard to get you to eat. When you hunger after God, anybody ever been like, I'm talking not just hungry because it's been 2 hours since you ate, but I'm talking really hungry. Like, anybody ever been really, 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 like you haven't had food for a period of time? It's amazing when food's put before you how good it looks, how wonderful it tastes, and it really doesn't matter a whole lot what it is, because if you're hungry enough, everything looks good. When you're hungry for God, you'll see his presence in everything that goes on around you. God is at work. But here's the flip side I want to say to that whole point. God is always at work every time we come together. But so is the enemy. And whereas God wants to turn everything for good, the enemy wants to pervert everything for evil. So often in the church world, there's always this tension when we talk about being filled with the Spirit. There's this tension of saying for people to have that desire because, well, I've done that before and I've tried that and it didn't work. I prayed the prayer and people did their thing and whatever, and it didn't work for me. I want you to understand this, that God's desire for you, it's in your notes, and I didn't highlight it in your notes, I did in mine. It should be highlighted in yours. When we talk about the Holy Spirit indwelling, infilling, God wants you to experience fulfillment. Don't let anything get in the way of that understanding. Say, well, I didn't have the experience I was wanting to have. This is my opinion. It's been my experience in life. When I stop seeking the experience and I start seeking God, the experience becomes a byproduct of my seeking. When I seek an experience, more times than not, it becomes unattainable. It becomes elusive because the harder I try, the less successful I am. And I think that goes back to the whole thing I kind of started off with. It's because we're not fluent in God. So the harder we press, the more we make it difficult to get there. Now, hear what I said. God's desire for you in all of this and in life is that you experience fullness, that you have fulfillment in your life. But note this, the devil wants to produce frustration. What does frustration cause all of us to want to do? Quit. You ever been working on a project and you go, they didn't send me the right screw for this thing, and before long, you're like, just give me, where's my toolbox? I'm getting some other screws. And before long, it's like, well, it doesn't quite fit right together, but it's the best I could do. Why? Because you got frustrated. And rather than taking a deep breath and calling a friend who's more mechanical than you are, you pressed on. And sometimes anybody ever do this? You just say, you know, this cheap thing of trash right here, I'm just going to throw it where it belongs, in the trash. I should have never bought that to begin with. And we blame, this is not like self-confession moment, just for the record too, by the way. I saw Janet nodding over here. We blame the product when the reality is the fault lies in the user. Please understand this principle. If you don't get anything else, get this today. God's desire for you is to experience fulfillment in your life. Grab hold of that, hang on to it, believe it. Whatever you're going through, God's going to bring good out of it. God's going to bring growth out of it. The devil's trying to produce frustration, which will get you to quit. And if you don't quit, you'll be angry and upset and not very productive. That right there was worth coming today to hear that word for you. Ezekiel 47 gives the story of water coming out of the temple. And it's a picture of experiencing the Spirit of God. And I've preached the sermon on Ezekiel 47. I think it says Isaiah in your notes. That was just a typo. It should be Ezekiel. Ezekiel 47. First of all, the ESV says it's trickling out. We had a leak the other day in the gym area by the water fountain, and it was the weirdest leak. Pastor Mike was looking at it, working on it. I went over and I looked at it because the leak was coming out so slow. It truly was just trickling out of the wall, and you're kind of like, how's it doing this? This is a weird thing, and we figured it out. He figured it out, got it fixed, and that sort of thing. But a trickling thing is not that big of a deal. The Bible says at first it was just trickling out, then it became ankle deep, then knee deep, then waist deep, and it's talking about the presence of God, the Spirit of God, and finally the water was deep enough to swim in. Here's what I've seen in my life. There are some Christians who love to go around kicking in the trickling water and acting like they really had this phenomenal encounter with God. And if they ever get to where it's ankle deep, they'll think, oh my, nobody's ever had this before. This is incredible. And can I tell you, wherever you're at on the spiritual continuum of knowing God, there's yet water to swim in. There's the depth and the fullness of God that He wants you to know. I used this illustration before, and I'll make it kind of quick. But you receive the Holy Spirit at conversion. And to use the illustration, I've got a pitcher and I've got a cup here and I've got water. Normally I've had a tray up here and I've talked about overflowing. I'm not overflowing today, I'm just filling up, okay? So water is a symbol of the Holy Spirit in the Bible. And we are called containers in a couple of different places in the Bible. And so this represents the Holy Spirit, this represents the life of a believer. When you get saved, you receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in you at conversion. Pretty much every Christian faith believes in that reality because that's what it means to be saved, and part is having the Holy Spirit in you. But there is, how many of you know when you get saved, it's commencement. It's not finality. It's not you've made it, you've arrived. It's you're getting started. And how many of you know when you got saved, although you felt like it couldn't be any better than this, there was more of God for you to grow in. And the more you studied the Word, the more you prayed, the more you fellowship with believers, the more you did the things that help you attain spiritual growth, the more you did those things, the more filled with the Spirit of God you became. And then you get filled all the way up to the point where you are full. And I don't know, I'll go quite to the top, but that's pretty close. Now, the problem with all of us, Paul says about us as containers that we are clay vessels. And the problem with clay pots, not crack pots, but clay pots. Maybe some are cracked, but they all leak. We have a tendency that what we have, and Moses tried to do this. He tried to make it seem like that he had the glory of God in such power that it would never depart. So the Bible tells a story about Moses after he encountered God that he put a veil over his face so that the Israelites would not see the glory that was visible declining. Sometimes we try to put on this mask of spirituality, but the reality is all of us in the room, me, you, the people around you, all of us, we need constantly to be refreshed and refilled with the Holy Spirit, because every time we get bumped, it kind of just gets knocked out of us a little bit. Being filled with the Spirit is certainly the goal of every believer, but there's a higher level that we're called to, because right now the cup contains the water. Baptism, by its very nature, means to be dipped into, and that's why we practice baptism by immersion. That's, in my opinion, the most biblical approach toward baptism. And baptism in the Holy Spirit means the cup goes into the water, and now it's no longer the container, it's being contained. Now we're no longer having the Spirit in us, but we are in the Spirit. It's kind of like my friend told me a while back when I've told you the story. He said, I need to confess to you, Pastor. He said, and I'm thinking, oh my goodness, what's he done? What's the problem here? And he said, I got up the other day, I was reading the Word, I was praying. I said, God, I want you to go with me today everywhere I go, and I want you to be with me in everything I do today. And he said, the Holy Spirit just stopped him and said, who do you think you are? I was really proud of his prayer, to be honest. I thought it was a great prayer. And he said, the Holy Spirit said, who do you think you are praying that kind of prayer? Asking me to go with you? And he quickly realized the error of his thought, and he said, God, I want to ask you to lead me today where I need to be and guide me today and let me go with you. See, when we are in the Spirit, we're no longer guiding. That cup has no control right now except what the pitcher gives to it. It can't move on its own. It can't be picked up without the pitcher being picked up or getting your hand wet or something anyway. It is totally encapsulated by the Spirit of God. That's what God wants us to experience. Second thing is the Holy Spirit works to develop Christ-like disciples. So this is going to be like a pneumatology 101 in about 7 minutes here, okay? Really quick with this. Speaking in tongues is the initial physical evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Proof for that is in the book of Acts, where three times it clearly says they were baptized in the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues. Two other times it talks about being baptized in the Spirit, but doesn't mention speaking in tongues, but alludes to the fact there was something that was visible, something to see, something happened that could be measured, if you will. You go to 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, you look at New Testament history, and you look at recent church history. Pentecostals have been more involved and connected to the spread of the gospel than any other component of Christian faith over the last 100 years. And that's why it's important. So why speaking in tongues? Why did God make that the thing that was the indicator you've been baptized in the Spirit? I think there are three reasons. Number one, it was practical. When the gospel was preached to the masses on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 1, it was people who didn't know a language speaking a language they didn't know, and other people hearing the gospel in their own language. Now, some who do not embrace Pentecostal thought look at only that one reference for tongues and says, well, tongues is only okay if you're speaking a language that someone that you don't know, that someone else does know, and God's using that, whatever. Well, that's how it happened in Acts 1. That's not how it happened in Acts 10. So you can't take one illustration and make that universal. Paul actually refers to it as praying in an unknown tongue. So I think more times than not, it's not a known language except known to God, and it's not a word that speaks to someone else most typically, but it was on that day. Second reason is a personal note. The Bible says, James says, that your tongue or your mouth is the most difficult member of your body to control. So when God said, when I want to indicate the fact that you've given control of your body, your life, to the Holy Spirit, I'm going to illustrate it through the tongue and the words that you speak. It also has to do with having humility to speak out in ways that recognize that we're not dependent upon our own wisdom, our own understanding. But how many of you, asking for a friend, not for you necessarily, but how many of you have ever known of someone that had difficulty controlling their mouth? You don't have to, it's not you, I'm sure. Well, I probably shouldn't say it, but I've never heard anybody stop at that point. It's an acknowledgement of what I'm about to do shouldn't be done, but I'm going to do it anyway. Why? Because the mouth is hard to control. The mouth erupts with anger. Have you ever been sitting by someone when all of a sudden something happened that just made them angry to the point that it was uncontrollable, and they yell something out and you go, where did that come from all of a sudden? The Holy Spirit helps us to control our words. A third reason is because spiritually our voice was designed to glorify God. And so the Spirit helps us do that. Now let me go on, but past speaking in tongues, to the second part, which is the continuing evidence of the Holy Spirit's control of your life, is the fruit of the Spirit. There are 9 aspects of one thing, so it's not 9 different qualities. It'd kind of be like this. If you were talking about something that was salted caramel brownies or whatever, you might say, describing them, they're salty because they're salted caramel. They're sweet because they're caramel. They're gooey if you make them right. If they're crunchy, you made them wrong. They're moist. So you can say all these different words, but you're not really looking for one of those words to be the description. And the reality is one by itself doesn't really make the description of what you're eating. If you say, well, describe a salted caramel brownie to me, and you said, it's sweet. How many of you know you could be talking about chocolate or ice cream? If you say it's salty, it might be a pretzel. But as you bring all the things in together and people give you more clues about what you're describing, before long, you realize that's a salted caramel brownie, which, by the way, are delicious. Just, I'm not asking for anybody to bring you to the church, but if the Lord should speak to your heart, just be obedient. Just kidding. Can you laugh occasionally and just enjoy life? Okay, that was a joke. I don't think any of us we love them, but we probably don't want to eat them because we're all trying to watch weight. We're at that age, all of us, every one of us. I'll stop right there and we'll go on. So I'm digging a hole that has no point, so stop doing it. Put the shovel down. That's what I always told my kids. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace. I've preached on this before and would love to come back and do this series again, but just talking about what the fruit of the Spirit looks like. Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. The problem is too often we pull out one or two and we go, woohoo, I got the fruit of the Spirit. No, you got salt and sugar, and you could be a whole lot of things. You got to get the whole package, the full description. The gifts of the Spirit, and I won't take long to go here this morning, but there's at least 20 in the Bible from Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians chapter 4. And the purpose of spiritual gifts is for the benefit of the receiver of the gift, not primarily the affirmation of the one God uses to deliver the gift. So I've heard people say things like this. It normally has to do with music for some reason. I've heard people say, well, singing is my spiritual gift, and if I can't sing, then I feel like I've been shortchanged in life. I love to proclaim the word of God. I love to teach the word of God, but if I never did it again, I would never say I've been cheated. Hopefully, the gift benefits you that hear. And if I'm just up here trying to make myself feel good, we ought to just skip the whole thing and let's just go eat lunch. The gift is not for the affirmation of the one who uses the gift. It's for the benefit of others. And when I hear people say, well, I have this gift, but they don't let me use it, I don't really even know what that means. I think for a lot of people, it means between 10:30 and 11:45, they wouldn't let me do my thing. I'm not making anybody happy with this, but that's not my job, so it's okay. Because see, if you really feel like you got the gift of preaching, I can line you up with some nursing homes around town. There are some jails, some places you can go and you can proclaim the word. Well, I really need to sing. I need to play the piano. That's my spiritual gift. Okay, then use it. Are you using it? No, I'm not now. Nobody will let me because they won't let me be on the stage at 10:30. I'm not trying to be mean. Too often we're very selfish in our view of life. Lord, help us know that every spiritual gift you've placed in us is for the benefit of others. And to operate in that capacity so that we bring honor and glory to your name. The Holy Spirit is essential to every Christian. Let me wrap it up with this. The fullness of the Spirit's indwelling is just as much of God's desire for every Christian as salvation from sin. Here's what I mean by that. Let me define my terms the way that I'm trying to communicate it to you. It is not God's will for you to be a struggling Christian. Suffering, stumbling, not sure if I can make it. Pray for me, church, that I can hold on to the end because I'm losing my grip and the devil's chomping at my feet and I'm about to slide down the hill and I don't think I'm going to make it. It's not God's plan. God's plan is for you to be saved, first of all, and then secondly, once you are saved, to be filled with the Holy Spirit to the level that you're living a life of victory, not defeat. That you're walking in the fullness of God. that it's not just a Sunday, Wednesday, or for today, a couple times a month. But it is a 24/7 letting God direct your life. The Holy Spirit is necessary for you to live a holy life. He's called the Holy Spirit for a reason. He produces a spirit of holiness. Maybe you hear me differently than I hear myself, but I read guys occasionally saying, no one talks about repentance anymore, and nobody talks about holiness anymore. And I look back at my notes and I go, I do every week. Because it's the gospel. How can I not call you to be people who repent of sin? How can I not encourage you to walk in holiness? Because that's the way of life. And I'm not talking about just some list of do's and don'ts. I'm talking about being filled with the power of the Holy Spirit every day. Trying to serve God without the Spirit's empowerment is like trying to drive your car without starting the engine. You've got to have the power of the Spirit. And honestly, I'm not really interested in debating with you what that looks like. I'm saying seek God and let Him do in your life what He wants to do in your life. This is just me talking from my experience. From my upbringing, I've seen people through the years at different places that they acted like speaking in tongues was reaching the peak of Mount Everest. And if you ever got there, you got to plant the flag and go, woohoo, I got it. Sometimes I see those same people, though, not living in the fullness of God after that point. I believe in speaking in tongues. I speak in tongues daily. It helps my prayer life. You need to speak in tongues. I don't want you to miss that point at all. I would encourage you to seek the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. But I also want to tell you that more than just that evidence and experience, there's a lifestyle that you can start in today of seeking God's Spirit filling your life. One of my views of spirituality is, for the most part, it should be organic. And by that, I simply mean this. It doesn't require outside forces pressuring to make things happen. It comes internally. When I look at Acts chapter 2, they'd had the promise of Jesus, and I don't mean this wrong, and I don't want to offend anybody, but they didn't have anybody in Acts chapter 2 coming up behind the disciples and saying, lift one hand, say hallelujah 42 times, do this, do that, and if you do it long enough, you're going to get it. Keep going, hold on, let go, turn loose, push in. I'm tired of all the mechanics. I just want the fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit that's not manipulated, that's not even directed, but it just falls from heaven. You know what I see happen in Acts chapter 2? They're just praying with hearts full of worship. And the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Oh God, do it again. Oh God, do it again. So that we're not consumed with our differences, but we're united in our faith in this church. We're united in our purpose. The Holy Spirit gives us power, and we use the five words we talk about around here sometimes about our church. Gives us power to serve. You're a better servant when you're filled with the Holy Spirit. You're a better worshiper when you're filled with the Holy Spirit. When you're filled with the Spirit, nobody has to prime you to join in. I never saw it, don't know, but I believe it's true. Heard a story about in a foreign country, I'll leave it at that, but where they have a little bell up front, and it's the bell's for prayer time. It's not to start it, it's to end it. Because they say that if they don't ring the bell, the people will just keep on praying. They'll never get anything else done in the service. God, deliver us from entertainment. Deliver us from words of man's wisdom. And let your Spirit reign. Let your Spirit reign. Let me close with this verse, Ephesians 5, 15 through 20. Stand with me if you would. I didn't give the five words, but power to serve, worship, grow, connect, and invest in the work of the kingdom, not just with money, but with our lives. Ephesians 5, look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit. Here's how you know when you're filled with the Spirit. You address one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You sing and you make melody to the Lord with your heart. You give thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. On this Pentecost Sunday, when we think about the Holy Spirit descending upon those who are gathered in the upper room and spreading across Jerusalem and eventually through the book of Acts into Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth, can we in this room to say, do it again, Lord. Do it in my life. One of the ways that we worship God, the Bible says, Old Testament and New Testament, we worship Him with lifted hands, which is more than the physical action. It's the heart of the Spirit that says, I humble myself before you, God. I acknowledge your greatness. Would you lift your hands and lift your voice and worship to God this day? We thank you, Lord, for all of your blessings. We thank you for your goodness.